Sing our first hymn, and then we'll do our birthday blessings right after that. So
let's turn to number 696 and sing America the Beautiful.
May be seated, unless you had a birthday in June. If you had a June birthday, come down and let us bless you this morning. Hey, there we go. Here comes some more June birthdays coming down. That, I think, for weddings and birthdays. All right, very good. Come on over here and stand with us. All righty, thank you. We ask everybody to give a little blessing to our missions fund as we give a blessing back to them on their birthday. So real briefly, tell us what was a blessing that you received this year on your birthday, KT?
Family. Well,
family. Now you can't be that one. Come on now. What else?
Friends,
okay. How about you?
Family and friends.
Family and friends, and maybe that we've become a official teenager now, yeah. That we're 13. Okay, very good, all right. How about you? What did you get for your birthday that was neat? You get some presents?
I got some presents.
That's good, isn't it? Did you have a birthday party? Did you have a cake?
No, because they didn't
pop it out. Oh, pop. Mop it up. Okay, so that was a cool place to go for your birthday. All right, how about you, Tom?
My three little granddaughters and I went to Mr. Auburn, and it was really special. Yeah.
Well, nice. How fun is that? All right. Well, we're going to sing happy birthday to all these folks. And when we get to their name, we'll just say God bless you. All right. So join for us at happy birthday. Happy If you'll look over on the back of your bulletin, we do have some things to put on there. Next Sunday, I can't believe it's already coming up. Next Sunday, I'm going to be taking five senior high youth on a mission trip. We're going to be going to Crockett, Texas, and joining several other youth groups from around Texas to do some work in that community. We do everything from building wheelchair ramps to porches to hanging sheetrock, painting houses. Roof repair, about the only thing we don't do is electrical work and plumbing. Those are the two things we are no-nos for us. But we would covet your prayers as we leave on that trip. And our group has been asked to bring some things to help make the camp run smoothly. We've been asked to bring paper towels, toilet paper, and Clorox wipes. So if any of you would be willing to help us gather some of those materials together, you can get with me this week. But we're supposed to bring toilet paper, paper towels, and Clorox wipes for the camp so that they don't have to spend money to purchase those things, and that money can still be used for materials to help the folks in Crockett. So that's going to be coming up next Sunday. We'll be leaving for that trip, and I'll be gone that whole week with those kids. But of course, I'll have my cell phone with me if any emergencies or anything come up. But we would appreciate your prayers as that comes up. I talked to you guys a little bit last week about some plans to improve and make our Harvest Festival better this year. And I'm going to go ahead and start these around. We talked about putting together different teams of people that can take over one element of the event and really try to make that part of it really be the best that it can possibly be. There was one element of that I didn't describe to you last week, and so I want to describe that to you now because it'll look kind of funny when you see the sign-up part of it. It's the animal fundraising team. All right? One of the things that we just got back from Clarendon on Saturday. They have their big 4th of July celebration on a Saturday with a parade and everything, and the Lions Club there does a fundraiser called Cow Patty Bingo. And they have a little pen that they set up out by the courthouse, and they put a grid in there with the chalk, like you'd chalk off the baseball field and everything. And then they have a poster board with that same grid on it. And you can buy squares on that deal. And when they fill up their grid, they've sold all the squares, they let a cow or a calf out in the pen. And wherever he goes, if he goes in your square, you win the money. Some money, and then the rest of it goes to the Lions Club. And so we're going to try to have Cow Patty Bingo out here on the North Lawn for the Harvest Festival. And then Becky's sister, they did a fundraiser for their cheerleading squad up in Dalhart. They called it the Chicken Plop. And it was basically the same idea, using a chicken instead of a cow. So we're going to have both of those. We'd like to have both of those as fundraisers because we're kind of not able to do a quilt raffle anymore because it's just too expensive to buy the quilt. And so these would kind of take the place of the quilt raffle is to do these animal fundraisers. So if you're willing to be a part of that, if you look inside the notebook, you can take one of these pages over here. It gives a brief description of what each team is responsible for. And then you have an opportunity to sign up for the team that you want to be on. If you get to the notebook and this team that you want to be on is already full, just put your name on there anyway. We can have teams of 6, 7, 8 people. It doesn't matter. I just did it for space sake. put five blanks for each team. And of course, if you're on a team, you can also delegate things. You can make subcommittees and things like that, however you guys want to set this up. We want to make the Harvest Festival and Reunion a really awesome event this year. And so in whichever way, just pass that around, make sure it gets all the way around the church this morning. Then I'll also briefly describe to you what I was calling Operation 50 last week, where we're trying to find 50 people who will sign up and commit to pray for 10 people in our community, and we're we would like to be praying for 10 people who are not connected to a local church or who are not active in church anymore, and we're going to be working to try to get them back into church. We're going to try to have a big event of some kind here at the church, either this fall or in the spring, probably in the spring since we're doing Harvest Festival in the fall, but just a way to try to reconnect people to church. I was talking with my mom back home on Saturday, and she was telling me that, you know, the churches in Clarendon are facing the same things that we're facing. You know, it seems to be all over the place. People are just not going to church anymore. You know, and it's not just in the Methodist Church, it's the Baptist Church, it's the Church of Christ. They're all struggling because people are just not attending anymore. So it's something that one way that maybe we can get out and draw people back into the church. And so there's also a little description here that tells you what you're signing up for. So if you're committed to do the things on this list, then you can put your name on here and we can start that going around. And we'll be passing these around over the next few weeks to try to give as many people as possible a chance to sign up. Don't feel obligated to do it. Only feel led to do it. If you feel led to do it, then sign your name on there, because we want committed folks to do these things for us. All right. Are there any other announcements? Anything else that we need to lift up before the body this morning? Activities, community events, things going on that we need to be aware of this morning? All right. What joys can we lift up this morning? We had some rain. That's a joy. Do what? How beautiful everything is. Beautiful and green. And it looks really, really good out there. So what else are we happy about? Yes, Briley?
Turtle race.
Yeah, we went home and they have a big turtle race in Clarendon. If you've never seen a turtle race before, it's a pretty neat deal. Briley's turtle just nearly won this time. It was so close, but she was the only one that came close, I think. So, but we had a good time up there racing our turtles yesterday. Any other joys to lift up? Yes, sir.
We celebrated our 50th
wedding
anniversary.
This last week sometime, right, Orville? Yeah. I wouldn't wish that on anybody, Orville, but hey, we're happy that you guys have celebrated 59 years of marriage. Can we get a round of applause for that? That's awesome. What a blessing. What other joys can we lift up this morning?
Freedom.
Do what?
Freedom.
Yeah, that's what we're getting ready to celebrate in a couple of days, is just the freedom that we enjoy, and so oftentimes, I'm afraid, take for granted. In this country is just the freedoms that we enjoy. So that is a joy to lift up and always remember. Anything else? Who's that? Oh, Charlie had a birthday party. Great. All right. We'll do her birthday blessing at the end of this month then. All right. Sounds good. Anything else? No, 20. I didn't know he was born on the 4th of July. That's a kind of a cool day to have a birthday. All right. Anything else? All right. Well, let's Go to our prayer list this morning. We do have some updates here on some folks that are on our list. Rob Brown is hoping to come home from Temple tomorrow. That's the plan at this point, is to come back to Throckmorton. They've gotten his pneumonia under control. He's still going to be on some IV antibiotics for a few weeks for the infection. It's not in his blood. It's in his spinal column somewhere, and so they're still treating him for that. And so continue to pray for him, but I know they'll be happy to get back to Throckmorton. So if you get a chance to go by the hospital this week and visit him, I'm sure he would enjoy that. And then also, as many of you probably saw on Facebook, if you're friends with him, Mac Pirtle did not get a very good report from his doctor as far as his cancer. It has returned and has spread to various parts of his body. He is still in a fighting mood. He's going to be doing radiation and chemo, and not willing to give up on it yet. And so we just need to continue to pray for him. And if you get a chance to give him a call or text, or just let him know that you're thinking about him and praying for him, I'm sure that he would appreciate that very much. Are there any additions or other updates that we need to put on our prayer list this morning? Yes. Bruce Richardson. Okay. I don't know him. Oh, okay. Yes, I do. I do. I just didn't know that he was undergoing cancer treatment. Yes, I do remember him. I sure do. If any one of you have a contact number or something for him, please give that to me so that I can reach out and contact him this week. Are there any others that we need to add to our list or update on our list this morning?
John will be taking RA back to Temple, stopping by on Wednesday for vision testing.
Okay. So pray for RA and John as they make that trip. Okay. Any others this morning? All right, well, let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary.
Father God, we come to you and give you praise and thanks for this beautiful day that you've given us. A day in which we can come into your house and fellowship with one another and praise and worship you and hear your word. We pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts and our minds to receive the word that you have for us today. May it be a word that would challenge us and renew us and give us a boldness to leave this place and be your disciples to the world around us. We thank you for all the joys that have been lifted up this day, for birthdays and just celebrations and time with family and friends, for anniversaries and just all of the wonderful gifts and blessings that you give us. We especially thank you in this time for our freedom, the freedom that we enjoy as a nation to basically do the things, whatever we want to do, to praise you and worship you in freedom and not having to worry about being persecuted for our faith. Help us, Lord, not to take these things for granted, but to always give you thanks and praise each and every day. And Lord, we lift up these that are still suffering this morning, Lord, whether it be from loss of loved ones or just the pain of illness and frailty. And we pray that you would be with them in the way they need you the most right now, Lord. We especially lift up Rob to you as he prepares to come back home. And we pray that that journey would be made tomorrow and it would be smooth and easy for him. And that you would just continue to bring healing into his body. We pray for Mac, Lord. I thank you so much for his fighting spirit, and just we just pray that you would continue to give him strength, that you would work with the doctors, Lord, that you would provide healing through the treatments that he's receiving. Lord, we lift up Bruce to you, Lord. We just pray that you would help us to reach out to him and help him to know that we're here for him and can pray for him and maybe even offer him help as he takes treatment also for cancer. And God, we lift up R.A. to you. We pray for a safe journey for he and John as they go to the hospital this week. And we just pray for guidance and wisdom as they seek treatment for him as well and do the tests that they need to do. Lord, help us to just remember everyone on this list as we pray for them each and every day. And if there's ways that we can reach out to them in love, help us to do so. Lord, we pray for this town. We pray for everyone in this community, especially those this morning who are waking up today not knowing what it truly means to know you and have relationship with you. Help us by our actions each and every day to show the love and the joy of what it means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. We pray for this nation. We pray for the unity of our country, Lord, and we pray for revival in our land. We pray that you would raise up the church to be a guiding light to our leaders and to those who live in our country so that we can come together in peace once again. And we pray for our world. We pray for those this morning who don't enjoy the freedoms that we have. We pray for those this morning who don't even have homes to go to. Those that have been displaced by war and terrorism. Those of our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted and even killed for their faith. We have no concept of what that feels like. We've never lived under that kind of persecution before. So help us remember, Lord, to lift them up in prayer each and every day. And we pray that you would supernaturally reach into their place in the world and deliver them and restore them to a place where they have a home and can worship you in freedom and in peace. And God, when we come to those times when we don't know what to say or how to pray, help us remember we can always pray with confidence the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We could now have some ushers gather in the back, and we'll take our morning offering.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you would bless this offering, that you would help us to give with cheerful hearts, and that these funds would be used for your glory here in Throckmorton and around the world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Please rise to the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father,
You may be seated. We are going to continue our series this morning as we look at what I'm calling the grandest of all the Psalms, Psalm 119. We talked a little bit last week about how unique this Psalm is and also how overlooked it is, often because of its length. A lot of people just kind of skip over it and go on to some of the shorter Psalms in the Bible. But this Psalm is very unique in that it was designed, it was structured in such a way as that it was used to teach young people or young believers as they were coming into the faith to know what it meant to be a follower of God. And they would literally memorize this Psalm because each of the sections of the Psalm, the lines began with that letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So each of the letters of the Hebrew alphabet presented and are given 8 verses where each word begins with that letter, and it goes right on through the whole 22 letters of the alphabet. And that was kind of a neat way in which it was structured. Last week we talked about how this psalm tells us about God's law. And we talked about the 8 words for God's law that were used in this psalm, and they're repeated over and over and over again. But each of those 8 terms has its own special nuance to it. So they don't all mean exactly the same thing, but they all kind of center around the law of God. And if you'll remember, we talked about one of those words was law, and it referred to the Torah, the first 5 books of the Old Testament. I've preached on this before. You know, every young Jewish male, especially, I'm sure there were some females that did this too, but every young Jewish male over the course of their schooling would memorize most, if not all, of those 5 books of the Old Testament. It was a requirement for them. Remember, the word was spoken. It was orally transmitted. Not everybody had, everybody didn't have their own Bible or their own copy. They learned it by heart. And so there was the law. Then there was the word statutes. And statutes were the if-then statements in the Bible. If this happens, then you do this. Or if that happens, then you do this. And it was just kind of a way to make that big law practical on an everyday level. And then we had precepts. Precepts were big picture commandments of God. You know, overarching commandments like the 10 commandments. Do not steal, do not kill, those sorts of things. But then you had underneath that the word for commands. And that took those big picture precepts down to everyday level. If somebody kills somebody, you know you're going to do this. You're commanded to stone them or kill them. Or even in the New Testament, an example I gave you, Jesus says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you." And then we had the word for ordinances. And an ordinance was just something that God instituted, and he wanted it to be remembered. He wanted it to be celebrated by the people over time. In the Old Testament days, it was Passover or the feast days. In New Testament times, we're going to celebrate one of those this morning. It was Holy Communion or baptism. Those were ordinances, things that we do to continually remember God's promises and what God has done for us in our lives. Then there was the word decrees. You know, these were, you know, these, God would say something like, or the, you know, the prophets would say something like, you know, those who do not follow the commands of the Lord will be punished. That was kind of like a decree. And then you had the word for promise. You know, God promises things to us. These are things we hold on to, that we hold dear in our hearts to keep us and help us through tough times in our lives. I will never leave you nor forsake you. It's a promise of God. And then there's literally the word for the word of God. The written word, the spoken word, and ultimately Jesus Christ, who is the Word made flesh. All 8 of those words are repeated throughout this psalm. But there's more to it than that. This psalm is just so deep and rich, but it's not just about God's law. And we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. So if you want to join me, we're going to read a section here that kind of illustrates a different thing about this psalm. And it's, you see it throughout, but it's just really illustrated in these verses. Psalm 119, verses 33 through 56. Hear the word of the Lord this morning. And as I go, before I start, I want you to make note of those eight words as you see them. If you're one of the ones that likes to make notes in your Bible, you could even underline them in there. And then I also want you to be thinking in the back of your mind, I want you to get a picture of that stereotypical Christian. Not from a Christian's point of view, not what you think of when you think of who a Christian is, but I want you to think of, what are those people that are on the outside looking in? What are those people on the outside that aren't involved in church, that really don't know what it means to be a follower of Christ? What do they think of when they think of what a Christian is? And just kind of keep that in the back of your mind as we read these verses this morning. So here we go, Psalm 119, 33 through 56. Teach me, Lord, the way of your decrees, that I may follow it to the end. Give me understanding so that I may keep your law and obey it with all my heart. Direct me in the path of your commands, for there I find delight. Turn my heart toward your statutes and not toward selfish gain. Turn my eyes away from worthless things. Preserve my life according to your word. Fulfill your promise to your servant so that you may be feared. Take away the disgrace I dread, for your laws are good. How I long for your precepts. In your righteousness, preserve my life. May your unfailing love come to me, Lord, your salvation according to your promise. Then I can answer anyone who taunts me, for I trust in your word. Never take your word of truth from my mouth, for I have put my hope in your laws. I will always obey your law, forever and ever. I will walk about in freedom, for I have sought out your precepts. I will speak of your statutes before kings and will not be put to shame. For I delight in your commands, because I love them. I reach out for your commands, which I love, that I may meditate on your decrees. Remember your word to your servant, for you have given me hope. My comfort in my suffering is this: your promise preserves my life. The arrogant mock me unmercifully, but I do not turn from your law. I remember, Lord, your ancient laws, and I find comfort in them. Indignation grips me because of the wicked who have forsaken your law. Your decrees are the theme of my song wherever I lodge. In the night, Lord, I remember your name, that I may keep your law. This has been my practice. I obey your precepts. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now, I think if I checked it right, every single one of those eight words were in that section there at least once, sometimes multiple times. But I hope you saw something else in there as well, because Psalm 119 is not just a song of instruction about God's law. Psalm 119 is also a song of worship and praise. It's a song of worship and praise. I described this psalm last week as a diamond, if you'll remember, and the facets of that diamond. There were those eight facets that were the eight words we described. But I also want you to think there's some also words in there of praise that also make up facets of that diamond. Now, they're not all in these verses that we just read this morning. I'm going to describe a few of them that are found in other places in this psalm. But as we see, as we go through the whole thing, not only does it talk about the law and the precepts and the commands, it's also talking about how awesome and joyous and delightful it is to follow God. As far as God's word is concerned, several places, God's word brings us joy. That's found in verse 111. God's word brings us praise. God's word brings us delight, singing, and thanks. In the presence of God's word, we rejoice. We give thanks. We hope. We find comfort. There's even a verse in verse 131 where the writer's even panting after the word and the Lord. You see, following God's law is something that should bring us joy and delight. It sets us free. It gives us all kinds of reasons to be happy and joyous. But I want you to think for just a moment about if those folks outside looking in, and what do they think of when they think of the stereotypical Christian? Is it the person who's kind of stuffy and with their arms crossed and kind of looking down their nose, judging everybody and pointing out everyone's faults and how bad they are and how wonderful they are and righteous they are? Is that what they see? Is that what they think? As a youth pastor, I remember countless times at a youth rally or an event or something, and there would be an invitation to come and accept Christ, and there would be those teenagers that were just on that verge. They were just, they knew they wanted God in their lives, but at the same time they were struggling with this thought. And they would articulate it something like this. They would say, I really want to give my life to Christ, but I also want to have fun. And I know if I give my life to the Lord, then I'm not going to be able to go do all these things that I want to do. And so, you know, I even had some of them say, I think I'll just wait. I want to go have my fun now, and there'll be plenty of time to come to God later and be boring. Come on, you've heard it, you've seen it. Okay? They have this mindset that being a Christian is boring. That it's just a lot of rules that you have to follow. And if you don't follow them all right, then God's going to zap you or strike you down or something bad's going to happen to you. And there's no fun in it. And I think in some ways, the church over time has maybe kind of perpetuated that mindset in them, because in a lot of ways, it's easy to kind of fall into that kind of stuffiness. You know, we can't go over here because we might be contaminated if we go over here and be with these people or do these things with these people, because they're doing things that aren't good and aren't right. And so we're gonna separate ourselves and kind of just be our own little group over here. And we're only going to associate with each other, and we're not going to associate with them over there. But is that how Jesus acted? Is that how Jesus was? Did he just hang out with the people who were doing all the right things in their eyes? No, he went to parties. He went to tax collectors' houses and had dinner with them. In fact, he got in trouble for that, didn't he? Really? What is the disciples, the religious leaders, what is your master doing hanging out with those people? Those are bad people. He doesn't need to be hanging out with them. And yet Jesus did. And the writer of this psalm, does he sound unhappy to you? Does he sound, listen to some of the things. I don't know very many people who says, I find delight in your commands. Do you? I love your rules, God. I love them. Because they give me what? They give me joy. They give me freedom. See, perspective is everything, folks. Perspective is everything. If we come across as thinking that we can't, we're limited in what we can do, we're limited in who we can associate with, we're limited in those things, then we're going to be perpetuating the stereotype that people can't get in because of their past, or people can't get in because of their current lifestyle. You know, it's like the person who says, well, if I become a Christian, I can't go to parties anymore. Sure you can. Why can't you go to a party? You can still go to a party. You can still have fun. You can still dance. You can still, have a great time. But you know what you don't have to worry about? If you're in love with God and you have the joy of God in your heart and you're following His commands because you love Him, you don't ever have to worry about feeling guilty. You don't have to worry about ever feeling ashamed when you wake up the next morning and wonder what you did the night before, because you didn't cross those lines. You didn't cross those boundaries. You can still have fun and not cross those lines. You can still be a part of things and still have fun and be a part. Christianity is supposed to be fun, folks. Seriously, look at Jesus didn't go to the wedding at Cana and just stand there with his arms crossed looking down at everybody. Look at that guy out there dancing. Oh my gosh, shameful. Oh, he's going to hell. I know he's going to hell. That guy over there, he's really going to hell. Yeah, I don't even know why I'm here. You know, it's just my mother maybe come. But I'm standing here. These people, my gosh. I feel dirty being in the same room with them all. Jesus was out dancing. He was part, you know, he was having fun with everybody else. He was twirling them around and he was, you know, and he's like, you know, he maybe even felt a little, you know, Mom, what do you need? I'm having fun with my friend. Turn the water into wine? Really? Okay, fine. You know, he was having fun. You know, we like to think of Jesus, I don't know why we think of him as this stuffy, uptight person. You know, he wasn't. He modeled what it meant to live a Christian life and be in the world, but not of it. See, that's the key. We can be in the world. We can associate with people who don't believe the way we do. And if our faith is so weak that we're going to be contaminated by them, then what does that say about our faith? You know, we can still be around them and be okay. We can still model what it means to be a Christian and be okay and have fun and share the joy of what it means to be a Christian with those who don't know Him. And it doesn't mean you have to find a party to go to. You can do it when you go to, you know, fill up at gas down here at Allsup's or Clint's. You know, go in and be happy and be joyful and get to know the person running the cash register back behind the counter. Or when you go to eat at a restaurant, get to know the person who's waiting on you. I read a deal one time that really kind of made me sad, where it said that waiters and waitresses, they don't like Sundays because Christians are the stingiest tippers. The church people are the stingiest tippers. That's terrible. We should be the most generous tippers. Those waitresses and waiters should be fighting to work on Sunday, you know, fighting for that shift because they know the Christians are going to come. And they're going to be happy, and they're going to be joyful, and they're going to be polite, and they're going to get to know me as a person, and they're going to leave me a nice big tip out of the generosity of their heart, out of the joy of their heart. Man, that should be the greatest day of the week to be a waiter or a waitress, is Sunday. But it's not. You know, read this psalm. See how many times that psalmist talks about loving God's word, being delighted in His commands, longing after the law of God because it gives them freedom, it gives them joy, it gives them life. And then ask yourself, is that me? Am I living that each and every day of my life? I know I've got some work to do. Because I find myself, just like everybody else, you get kind of caught up in your own little world and you kind of get the tunnel vision and you're just worried about the day and what you got to get done and you're just running in here and running in there because you're in a hurry and you don't take time to visit with somebody or say hi to somebody or get to know somebody or talk to somebody because we're just focused on our worries and our cares. You know, may each day we wake up and say, help me, Lord, slow down a little bit. Slow down just a little bit and share the joy of God with somebody today. Whether it just be down at the convenience store or at the restaurant or at the hardware store or wherever I may find myself, may I share the joy of walking with the Lord with somebody today. And I guarantee you, it'll start to chip away at that stereotype that people have. It'll start to chip away at the resistance people have of being a part of the local church. And before you know it, doors might be opened and walls might come down and people might start saying, well, you know what? Maybe there's a little bit more to this Christian life than I thought there was. Because of you. Because of the joy that you share and you give. So as we observe one of the ordinances of God this morning, as we come to the table and partake in Holy Communion, maybe this be a time that you would say that prayer, that you would say, Lord, help me. Help me no matter where I am and no matter what's going on in my life right now. Maybe may I share the joy of the Lord with somebody in the coming weeks. As you take communion this morning, and remember that that's the kind of guy Jesus was. That's the kind of guy Jesus was. He didn't care what anybody thought. You know, he went where he needed to go, and he said what he needed to say, and he loved everybody. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this morning, and we're thankful. We're thankful for your word. We thank you, thankful for your law, Lord. Yeah, it's rules, but Lord, it's rules that give us freedom and joy. By following your commands and your precepts and your ordinances, we find freedom to live our lives fully without having to worry about guilt or shame or regrets. So help us, Lord, as we come to your table this morning, just to commit our lives to be a joyful people called Christian as we walk from this place and share the love of Jesus with everyone that we know. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we prepare for Holy Communion, the liturgy is found on the screen. It's also in your hymn book, beginning on page 12. Hear the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Now the great Thanksgiving is found on page 13. And let's read it with joy this morning. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water in the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Those who are assisting, please come at this time. Receive communion by intinction. You'll come down to the center aisle, and I'll give you a piece of bread, and you'll dip it into the cup and take the elements. Then you may spend time at the altar if you wish, and pray for as long as you would like. The table of the Lord has been prepared. Come all who are ready.
This being the July 4th holiday weekend, for several years now we have been singing God Bless the USA. And so if tradition holds, we'll continue to sing God Bless the USA. If you'll rise, join me in singing. Words will be provided on the screen.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. Defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, there ain't no doubt. There ain't no doubt.
May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, and to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you and keep you and take you from this place as a people of joy as you live out your faith and share the love of Christ with other people by your actions as well as your words. Amen.